All right. We have Krissy Krash here today. Welcome, Krissy Krash, Power Through the Fourth Whistle Roller Derby Podcast. How you doing?
I'm awesome. How are you?
I'm doing great. I am really excited that you reached out. This is going to be a really fun little chat here because you've got a lot of knowledge and I want to get as much of it out of you as I can for this podcast. It'll be great.
Do it.
Okay. So, one of the topics I get asked about a lot is talking about just balance as far as in derby, we become really imbalanced with our muscle groups. One leg is stronger than the other. The quads are stronger than everything else. So what recommendations do you have? What advice do you have? What path do you send people on to try and get balance out again? What do you see when you have your roller derby athletes that you're training?
Yeah. Yes, balance is a big piece of this. You know, I mean, we turn left. I always joke that I've turned left for 13 years. Like, of course, the one side of me is, you know, stronger, fitter, you know, better than the other. And one of the biggest things that I really focus on is doing full body. Like, I really believe that as a cross training athlete, making sure that we're hitting all of those muscle groups that aren't necessarily being engaged during roller derby is super important. But at the same time, focusing on a lot of single leg or like single side of the body workouts is really important, mainly because if you do have a dominant leg, what you're going to find is that when you're doing things like squats, like one side is doing a little bit more of the work than the other. So with Roller Derby Training Club, which is actually an app that I have those girls doing a lot of like single leg lunges. We're doing just things to make sure that their balance is on point on both sides. So it's a combination of single leg exercises for sure. And then also really, you know, because once roller derby is over, it's not like most people are going to continue exercising. They're actually going to slow down a lot. So if they can learn how to do full body exercises that really work all of them, then what happens is even after derby, they're going to have the skills to be able to maintain their fitness versus just focusing on, well, I need these specific muscle groups for roller derby.
Okay. And a friend of mine and I, we've been kind of experimenting with this a lot. We've been saying, you know, our strong leg and our less strong leg so that it isn't like negative. And we've been kind of experimenting with how much more should we do with the less strong leg to try and bring it up to speed. Like sometimes I'll do, you know, like 1 minute on one leg and a minute and a half on the other leg or 2 minutes on the less strong leg. Like, is there a really good ratio that you would recommend for that?
Great question. I have actually never had someone do additional work on that. And there may be people out there that are like, what? That's absolutely what you should do. But overall, like we just, I look at the body as a whole. And I usually just have them do whatever that, like that, you know, you're only as strong as your weakest body part, right? Mm-hmm. So you're not going to necessarily like back squat something that only your left leg can squat. Right. Like the body is going to even out those loads. Typically I have them do the same on both.
But okay. So there's no magic formula that idealizes this notion that me and my friend have.
I would love to hear your results at the end of this. Please let me know because maybe we'll be incorporating this into, you know, the programs that I run and stuff.
It's, you know, beta testing. it's just a little bit here and there where I'm like, I think we should do some more on the other leg.
Legit.
Yeah. So you do a lot of cross training with your athletes, a lot of body weight exercises, especially. Are there any of your like favorites that you want to talk about or things you like to batch together or anything?
Yes. So anyone who knows me knows that my favorite exercise in the world is the burpee. Mm-hmm. And it's for a couple of reasons. Number one, because it basically hits most major muscle groups on your body. It's a great version of strength training and cardio at the same time. You can kick your ass in less than 10 minutes anywhere. but the main reason that I love the burpee, and I have my girls once a month do 100 burpees for time, is actually not for physical performance. It's for mental strengthening. And where you go in the middle of doing 100 burpees is the same place that your mind goes when you're stuck behind the pack. When you're like jamming and trying to get through and you're not getting out, it's the same place your mind goes when you're in a penalty spiral, right? Mm-hmm. It's the same place your mind goes at practice when you just can't get that transition down and you keep falling or losing it. And so I love the burpee because I think that 100 burpees for time is one of the best ways to really play around with what does your brain say when things are hard. And then consciously use that time to choose a new thought and to actually like reprogram your brain. So burpee is my favorite one for sure.
I am so glad you brought that up because I did that 7-day thing last fall with you and I really loved it. A few of my teammates were in there too. And that was one of the biggest takeaways from the whole thing for me. Like I did it the one time and then I was like, wow, I was impressed. It was better than I thought it was going to be for the first try, but I knew I could do a lot better. So on my own, I decided that every once in a while, I just need to check on this again. I haven't done it monthly, but it was like a few months later, I did another check and I was in the same exact place. And I was like really annoyed by that. So then I started like looking up online, like how can I actually like optimize this a little bit better? And I learned that taking breaks is like the worst thing you can do because as much of a pain as it is to get slower and slower and feel like you're not doing a good job and like you're not getting through your sets, it's better to just keep going. And yeah, I shaved so much time off just doing that. And I shaved like a whole minute and a half. And I was just
amazing.
So excited. And you're completely right. It's so mental because I had so many thoughts going through my head. So after the second time I did it, in between when I learned how to optimize it, I started doing 100 burpees a day for the month of February. And I told myself, they don't have to be in a row, but you're still doing them because you're getting ready for your next like test. And then I told myself that when I had like 100 more followers on Facebook, that that's when I would do it. I thought I was going to have a whole month, but people snuck up on me and it was like 2 weeks later.
Yeah. From the burpee.
So yeah, then I go to do it and I'm like 40 in, and that's when your mind starts shutting down. And my mind's telling me like, you know, you don't actually have to do this today. You're not feeling that well. No one knows you're doing this except for you. Nobody really cares. Your followers do not care about this at all. But I was like, no, I set this for myself. I'm doing this for myself. I have to get through this mental breakthrough thing because this is totally a mindset thing for all those times when you don't want to do something and you have to push through.
Yep. The brain is sneaky like that. I mean, it will justify anything, whether it's not going to practice on a cold day or not getting to the gym in the morning. It's sneaky. And so when you do stuff like the 100 burpees, it gives you the space to practice that reprogramming and just noticing like where it comes up. Cause it's not real, you know, it's just habit.
No.
Yeah. Like, good for you. 100 burpees. Yeah. We call that in Crash Course and Transformation, we call that the burpee 3K, where you do 100 burpees a day for 30 days.
Oh.
1,000 burpees. Oh man. Life changing.
Yeah. I've got like a fun little side fitness group with just some friends, but now the podcast fans are in there too. And I do want to get to another burpee month because I think it's pretty awesome. I would like to see if anyone would want to go on the 100 journey with me, but it's a really varied group of people and I don't want anyone to like, you know, skip town for it.
Yeah.
You know what? We can say set your own limit, whatever goal you want for the month. Cause we're doing that right now with distance. And a lot of us have picked 100 miles and we're pretty much on track, but some people are like, you know what? I'm just trying to get 2 miles a day. That would be really big for me. And you know what? That's fantastic.
I love that. That's so fun. Yeah. First of all, high fives for you for building community. Like it's so important, like, especially inside of a sport to like collect people together that are moving towards similar like goal. Like that's so huge. I love that. So high five to you.
Yeah. Well, you do kind of learn after a while that if you're just posting stuff on social media, not everyone's into it. Not everyone's about it. Not everyone wants to hear about it. They might feel guilty or whatever is going on in their head. But if you find your people and you're like, this is the group of people who are all on the same path together, then you can support each other and you don't have to bother anybody else while you're doing it.
Yeah, it's fine. Exactly. A lot of my girls come across that when they join Crash Course and Transformation because they're like, they're so afraid to post about their journey. And it's like, it's okay. We have a safe space for you to do that. We have people to high five you because some people are just not ready to like put that out into the planet yet, you know?
Yeah. And your journey does inspire other people, but those few people who complain about it can really just grate on your parade and makes it tough.
Yeah. They can kindly unfriend.
Just unfollow me for a little while. I'm busy being awesome.
You're being awesome.
Yeah. I guess I do also get asked a lot about, like, I know you know a lot about nutrition, specifically Bout Day nutrition. People want to know more about, like, is there a magical formula for that or just best practices?
Yeah, great question. And I think people always look for the complicated, and the reality is it's not. You know, it's a balance of healthy proteins, complex carbs, veggies. You know, don't eat too much right before a game. Mm-hmm. A couple of things that I found. So I typically eat a regular breakfast, a regular lunch, like if it's a night game, a pretty regular dinner. And then I will bring things like dried fruit is a really helpful one. Sometimes I eat like gummy bears and stuff like that. but any kind of like an easy to process simple carb is great during a game. Mm-hmm. Which is where, you know, most people think, oh, I got a carb load the night before, right?
Yeah.
Newsflash, carb loading is not really a thing for roller derby. Like, you literally would have to deplete your carbs for a week ahead of time in order to then rebuild up the stores inside of your muscles. So no carb loading needed, for sure. Mm-hmm. Just making sure that during the time of the performance, you have enough access to easy carbohydrates. So I choose, you know, gummies, electrolyte beverages that have carbs in them, not the zeros, but the one with carbs, dried fruit, like dates and stuff like that are great. Even at halftime, like a tortilla with like some peanut butter on it, things like that are great.
All right. That's really good to know. I, for years, I've just been kind of like, well, you know, the night before I'll just throw a sweet potato in there and be good.
It's like your body doesn't know you're going to yeah. play roller derby tomorrow. It's not like saving that like somewhere. Yeah.
Well, I just tell myself like I'm giving myself a treat because I don't really have them all the time. And I'm like, you know, I just want to feel good the night before now. So it's even more of a mental thing now.
and that's totally reasonable, because the reality is a sweet potato is a great thing to eat any day. Mm-hmm. And so if it makes your brain happy the night before, girl, eat that freaking sweet potato for
oh,
sure.
Oh, they're so good.
I love them.
Yay. Okay. Well, let's see. You're really good at mindset stuff. You do a lot of this with your people. Yes. Is there something in general you come across like a lot with your athletes when you're working with them that like, is there, I don't even know how to phrase this question. Like, it just seems like derby's a little different than other sports in that you need almost a little bit more confidence building. Whereas if you talk to football athletes or something, they'll be like, oh, I should be out there every time. I'm the best on the team. Nobody knows how awesome I am. And in derby, I find a lot more often that there are people who don't know how good they are and have trouble seeing it and have trouble like with imposter syndrome and things like that. Do you do anything with helping people build confidence?
Yeah, absolutely. So there's two things that I primarily see a lot, and it's exactly that, which is the imposter syndrome of, you know, failing to acknowledge all of the awesome things that have happened already. Mm-hmm. And the second thing that I see a lot of is just this sort of all or nothing. Like, if it's not perfect, I'm a failure.
Yeah.
And so we focus in KCIT, we focus a lot on grace. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is really like giving yourself permission to like screw up, mm-hmm. giving yourself permission to grow, like developing a lot of self-compassion. Because what happens is when we develop self-compassion, it gives us permission to actually start taking more action, because there's less fear around failure. Mm-hmm. Which then when people start taking more action, what they see is, oh, I can actually be successful at things. Yeah. Which in turn starts to build their confidence. So part of it is helping people get out of their own way. And then also, you know, we focus a lot on celebration. I mean, ridiculous celebration. First of all, I have my girls post wins every single day inside the group so we can really get into the habit of acknowledging ourselves, because it is a habit, mm-hmm. right? But also like silly celebration. Like I've been like lately having my girls do things like high five themselves. Yes. Like, for the dumbest thing, like put my lunch in the car. Yes. Like,
oh, that's like, brilliant. You
know, finished my workout. Oh, or like patting themselves on the back, right? Mm-hmm. Because it's those little physical things that start to develop the habit of celebration. And the habit of celebration and self-acknowledgement mm-hmm. is really what's going to breed the confidence and the understanding that you're fucking awesome and being able to own it.
Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah. I just want to hug everybody and be like, no, you can do it. Yeah.
And forgiveness is a big one too. We focus a lot on self-forgiveness, putting the past in the past, you know, because a lot of us, we decide we're going to fail before we've ever started.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of girls, they walk into their 27 and 5 one day already deciding that they can't do it because they haven't done it the last 12 times.
Right.
You know? So really like being willing to like leave the past in the past is another really big one in terms of developing self-confidence and understanding that you don't have to bring everything that you've always done with you into your future.
Mm-hmm. We're actually trying something a little bit different with 27 and 5 this year. Instead of doing it at the very beginning of the derby season, coming back from the off season when people aren't at their best, we've been doing it. We've just been testing it when everyone's at their peak physical condition really late in the season and saying, okay, now you're good for an entire calendar year. And it's amazing how much less anxiety there is for individuals on our team who are absolutely capable of doing it, but it's really tough after the off season to go out there and do it because they're like, oh, this is when I can't do it. Here's where I'm feeling all the holiday, whatever. Like it just gets in their head and we all know that they're capable. And I love it that we're now testing them in a place where you're at your best right now. Let's go do it and get it done. And then it's off the table.
I love that. I think that's something that should be implemented everywhere because, you know, you come out of off season, you haven't been training, you've been eating whatever, right? And then coming in and being like, all right, now do this thing that's going to determine the rest of your future for the next year. Like, that's so stressful. Yeah. I love that you guys are doing that.
Yeah, well, it's a mindset thing as much as anything else. Like, I can't take seeing my teammates struggle like that in their heads when they are that good and they can do it anytime.
Yeah. And it's like, you know, they can do it.
Yeah.
You know, regardless if it's beginning of season or middle of season. But hey, you know, why stress yourself out?
Yeah. All right. Since you were awesome enough to reach out, I would like to give you opportunity to tell more people like what you do now, what you're about, because not everyone might know about your training background, what you do with everybody. Like if you have any like program upcoming that you'd like to talk about, like feel free at this time.
Oh, cool. Yeah. So for people that don't know me, so I've been playing roller derby for about 13 years. I started in 2006. I can't really do math. I think that's 13 years. I played bank track. I've played flat track. I've been a certified personal trainer as well as a fitness nutrition specialist for about the last 10 years. And I work primarily with roller derby athletes. Like this sport changed my life. You know, I was a smoker. I was a drinker. I was a bartender. All I ate was fast food. And then I found roller derby. I mean, my first roller derby pictures, I literally have a pack of Camel Lights shoved in my knee-high sock. Like, I think it's the funniest thing ever. And this sport just transformed me. You know, it gave me a reason to want to be better. It gave me a reason to stop drinking every day. It gave me a reason to quit smoking. And I'm so grateful for the journey that I've gotten to go on that I just literally, it's my life's mission to share that with other people, whether that's roller derby athletes, which is like, you know, I love this community so much that I just want to help people get better, not just at derby, but at their life.
Yeah.
Because I feel like how we do health and fitness is how we do relationships, is how we do career, is how we do the amount of happiness we experience, you know? And so it's like, I want so badly to pass that on to people. And that's really what Crash Course and Transformation was founded on. It was basically taking everything that I had learned for myself over a decade in becoming an athlete, losing 30 pounds, finding my joy, finding my truth, finding my organization, and everything I learned in 10 years. And I basically smushed it and packaged it up into a 12-week program. And so my goal is to be able to take someone from wherever they're at to on the path to sustainably wherever they want to be in 12 weeks. But like you did, we do have the 7-day challenge, which is free. It's the Build a Better Athlete Challenge. And people are totally welcome to go to krissycrash.com. And there's a sign up on there. People can join at any time. And they're welcome to do that as well. And then also, like I mentioned, you know, body weight workouts. We do have Roller Derby Training Club, which is an app. It's like 10 bucks a month. It's a great way to get 3 workouts a week right to your phone. So you don't have to think about it, you know? Mm-hmm. So basically just trying to help as many people as possible, as we can. And it's been such a blessing just to see how many lives have changed already. Mm-hmm. And thank you for letting me come on and share and contribute. I love what you're doing. I think it's fucking amazing. And just keep spreading the love, dude.
Yeah. And I love what you're doing too. Like several of my teammates were in there with me, like for the 7-day challenge. I felt like we all grew. I feel like I had to ask myself some questions that I didn't really want to know the answers to, but it was tough and it was a nice growing experience. And I still do some of those quick workouts that you shared that are totally beneficial. I'm absolutely going to get back to the 100 burpees again and see where I'm at. And a friend of mine has still been training with you. I'm not sure how long now Sawa has, but I love seeing the change in her life. She is a delightful person. Her skin is glowing. I can just tell she's really full of joy right now and is really happy with the changes that have happened for her.
She's amazing. I am so proud of her. I mean, she came into Crash Course and Transformation and was just like, let's go. Like, show me what to do. I will do it. She dropped, I think, 22 pounds over the course of the 12 weeks, I want to say. It was like 15 to 22. But it was so cool to see, like, the goal of this program is that after 12 weeks, you don't need me anymore and you just go off and running, right? And she just came out of this program on fire. And it's been so cool to see not just her 12-week transformation, but, like, this person that she has become in the process that she continues to unfold to be is so cool. It's so cool. I'm so proud of her. I love her to death.
Yeah, she's such a passionate person. She cares about so many people in her life, like taking care of everyone. And it feels like maybe there was like a blanket on top of her and you just help her take it off and she's just letting her light shine a lot brighter than before.
Oh, that's so beautiful. That's exactly what we're trying to do. You know, love and light.
Yay. Oh, thank you so much for reaching out. I'm so glad we got to talk today. Is there, what are the best ways to reach you on social media and whatnot for if people have questions or want to get in touch for these programs?
Yeah. At Krissy Krash on Instagram, all K's, no C's. Same thing on Facebook. You can find me under Kristen Adolfi under my real name, or there's a Krissy Krash page. And then if they want to, like I said, join any of the programs, ChrissyKrash.com has all the programs, all the applications, all that stuff on there as well.
All right. Awesome. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you.
I guess I'll talk to you later.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. Thank you so much. So when does all this stuff do its thing?